Okay, welcome Catamount Nation. My name is Kayla Deaton. I'm from Clayton, North Carolina. I'm a senior at Western Carolina University, majoring in public relations communication and minoring in marketing. And I'm also a student athlete. I run track and cross country, mostly the 5K. Would you guys like to introduce yourself, Vic and Chace?
Hi, I'm Victoria Solheim. I am a sophomore at Western Carolina. I'm a biology chemistry double major, and I am also on the track team. I am a thrower, which means I do all the events. So I do shot put, hammer, discus, weight, and javelin.
All right, I'm Chace Washington-Saunders. Yeah, that's awful. Don't ask me. I'm a psychology and sociology major. I'm a senior. I transferred in about 2 years ago. And I run the 4-2, and I can step down and do the 1, depending on what the coaches ask for.
Is it my turn now?
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm Manteo. I'm a freshman at Western Carolina. no, I'm kidding. 2009 and 2012 alum from the greatest university in the world, Western Carolina University. Ran track there. Did a lot of interesting things there. So I'm pretty sure we'll talk about those things. So that's enough for now.
What did you say what your events were?
200 and 400, really everything.
Okay.
My coach put me in everything, but mostly known for 400 and sometimes 200. Yeah.
Very cool. Okay, so you kind of spoke a little bit about the best university in the world, Western Carolina. What were some of the highlights of your career at WCU?
Highlights of my career, I don't know. There was so many, like, on and off the track, and they complemented each other. As far as on the track, obviously the goal that we had in mind, not only me but my teammates as well, is just winning those conference championships. Like you all know, you just want to win those. So that was first and foremost on the track, but also in the classroom, just trying to excel there as well, trying to stay on top of your tasks, getting your work done. Obviously, everyone had, you know, different majors. Some of us had the same major. I was a sport management marketing major. But being able to have a few teammates, or even not even just track and field, but just athletes in general in class with you, it kind of even made it more of a competition inside the classroom as well. It's like, hey, what'd you get on that test? They were like 96. I'm like, I got 96.5. So, you know, just things like that. Those were great accomplishments, just being able to be successful both on and off the track. But obviously, you know, on the track, like I said, winning the conference championships, beating App was just amazing in itself. I know you guys don't really have that rivalry anymore. But again, like I said, in the classroom, just trying to be an all academic team and to try to hold the standard that our coaches and administrators put before us was pretty much the goal.
Awesome. Vic and Chace, are there any highlights of your Western career so far that it really stood out to you either on or off track?
I am a 4.0 student right now.
Wow.
Double major. And my freshman indoor season, there's an indoor season, which is from December to around February, for track. And I won my conference championship my freshman year for weight throw. So
nice.
I did that. That was really fun. And everything else, I got second and third place for most of the other events, but I think that was really great because coming in my freshman year, I didn't really think I was going to be able to get to that area, but I worked really hard with all of our coaches and all of the team athletes help. It's more of a family. Like, I know that everyone here knows how close-knit that everyone is, and I think that's one of the biggest things about Western is just not only is the track really homey, but everyone at school is, and like with in your major classes, you have so many people with you that are cheering you on as well as you're trying to cheer them on. And I think that's one of the best things.
Yeah, it's definitely Go ahead.
I was going to say, I don't know if I can say like my whole time has been like a highlight because I've only been here for 2 years, but Western Carolina was like the best choice transferring in and being able to do what I did in that short amount of time of being here, dropping time and scratching into my potential. So I would say the whole time, because the last 2 years I've not done what I wanted to do, but that was probably more my fault than anything. But I appreciate the whole experience, and I made lifelong friends. I can call brothers and sisters at the end of the day.
Right. I think that's one of the best aspects, not even just about being a part of a sports team, but Western in general, is just that community aspect. There's so many people there to support you and help you in and off the track and in the classroom, like Anita and Demetria and all of them. I don't know if you had study hall while you were here, Manteo. But did you guys have study hall?
Yeah, we definitely had study hall. It was mandatory incoming freshmen until you achieve the GPA that, you know, would place you out. I think that's still the same process with you guys.
Right.
So, yeah, we had another alum, Jamal Mayo. We had Aaron Mazel. We had Mr. Spencer, Jason Spencer. Wow, I cannot believe I remember these names. There was one more, Dr. Brown. Can't remember who else. And then, you know, once I got out of study hall, thank God, I actually, you know, loved helping the student athletes so much that I was actually working in study hall. Being able to like tutor and things like that was pretty cool. I definitely remember study hall getting a certain amount of hours per week or something like that. I don't remember the exact process, but it sounds like that might be right. Try to get up out of there. And that's not a bad thing to get out of, though. So if you're in study hall, student athletes, the goal is get out of there. Like, just get out. I think I like that. I'm pretty sure Western isn't the only school that does that, but I'm glad that an emphasis on education could be placed on the athletes because, like I said, you're holding yourself accountable. You're not just here to do your sport. You're a student first. It's student, then there's a dash, and then there's athlete. So you have to take care of all that stuff first, and then everything else kind of falls into place if you play your cards right.
Mm-hmm. Right. So would you have any tips for student athletes who are trying to balance both school and track? I guess it's open floor to anyone or a sport in general.
I'll let you guys go first. I know the answer to that.
I try to use time management. I think that's my biggest thing is time management, because that's like one of the utmost important things in every schooling career, as well as careers in general, like not just athletes and not just school, but just like day-to-day basis. If you don't prioritize what you have to do and what is the most important, like to get done in the first place, then you're never going to get or achieve anything that you need to do. So my biggest thing is just to make sure that I organize all of the things that I have to do and sort them in a list of like when they're due and what to do in case prior engagements come up. Say like you have a track meet and you're about to miss a test, you have to talk to all of your teachers and you have to make sure that they know that you're prioritizing their class and their schoolwork over anything else, because as as Manteo said,
okay. I've been going through this for years. It's all good. I promise.
It's all right. My last name's hard too. But as he said, it's just you're a student athlete. Like you're a student before an athlete. It's not many people can achieve what he has in his life, especially going through college as a student athlete. Not a lot of people are going to be silver medalists in the Olympics. Like it's just not, that's not usually what happens. There's so many things that you have to do with your life, in my opinion, that you need to prioritize and make sure that you have set on a certain standard before you compete in anything else that you want to do.
Mm-hmm. Chase?
I feel like I've been in school forever. Like she said, it's time management. That's really at the end of the day. I tell people all the time, college is not super duper hard. It's just how you balance your time and how you balance that time as well as you doing your sport. There's periods of time where I'm in class and I'm like, I just want to get to practice. But I know class is more important right now. So focus on that, get that done, get the homework done so I can focus on the things I need to focus on. And I mostly try to live my life, especially as a student athlete, stress-free. So I can get all the stuff I need done, then I can worry about the stuff I need to worry about, track meets or at practice or whatever the case may be. So being in school for like the last 5 years from two different schools, time management has been the thing that has saved my life, honestly.
Right. I'd say for me, it's a combination of all the things you've all said. And then I'll dig a little bit deeper and I'll take it from the athlete perspective. Whether your sport, whatever your sport is, there's always an end goal. For me, obviously this year, put an asterisk beside it. 2020 Olympics was the goal, but obviously you don't say, okay, if the games start on August 9th, let's say, okay, August 8th, I'm going to train to be an Olympian again, but that's not how it works. So you take 2020, whatever that looks like, and you work your way back. And then that's how you set up how you're going to achieve that goal. So I think if you take that perspective and you place it in all endeavors of life, whether it be in the classroom or if you're trying to accomplish a goal outside of college or anything like that, I think if you look at it that way, if you really carefully plan, I think setting small attainable goals that lead up to a major goal are very beneficial. A lot of people, you know, just try to believe in the overnight dream or the weight loss pill. There's no such thing. You have to work hard in anything that you do, not just in sport or in the classroom, but you want to give your very best effort in everything, especially with, you know, the things that are going on right now. And imagine just leaving your event or your sport or where you were currently at and knowing that you didn't give your very best effort. I wouldn't want to live with that. So I think that's kind of how I tell people. I talk to people all the time about just trying to give your best effort in everything that you do, so that way you don't have any regrets when you leave from it. Yep.
That's good advice. So you've been to the Olympics before, right? What was that like? And what made you want to go back in 2020?
Well, it was boring. I just wanted to just take the flight, really. I'm kidding. like, what? 2012 was amazing in itself. Lots of experiences, lots of friendships made. Obviously, going in is enough, but to go and come back with a medal for what I say, not only myself, but for my community, for my family, for my Catamount family, like to just make all these people proud and have them give them something to believe in and be proud of. That was the true goal for me. I know I came back with silver, but that was the true goal for me is being able to give something to the people. The experience itself was amazing. Anything that you can imagine having was given to you. If I needed something, it was provided. My coach and I, we had a plan and we executed that plan and it just so happened to work out. And the crazy thing about it is we executed this plan every day in Cullowhee, North Carolina. That's the craziest part about that. So that just goes to show that it doesn't really matter where you're at. It doesn't really matter, you know, if you have everything provided for you, as long as you do, like I said earlier, all the small things that add up to the big thing. You can do something special, whether you're in Cullowhee or Charlotte or Atlanta. It doesn't matter. It's all about what's inside of you. You have to bring that out. So I've always been proud to wear the purple and gold. I don't always wear it on my body all the time, but I definitely wear it in my heart every single day. Just going to the games was just, I can't really put it into words. There's so much that you experienced there. And I'd wish that everyone could experience, not only as an athlete, but even as a spectator, even if you just went to the games, like it's just unbelievable to be in an area with the greatest athletes of all time or in that era. And you get to watch them. Like I literally ate and watched LeBron James play basketball at the highest that you can go. I mean, I watched Kobe. I watched Michael Phelps win 8,000 gold medals. So to be able to see that, I saw the Fab Five do the unthinkable and they won the team. So just to be able to experience that stuff and just know that you were in the room, that even inspires you as well. So just being around high caliber, high class athletes and just all around great people, that can make you aspire to be even better as well. So I think that was the biggest, you know, takeaway that I got from it. And then going forward now, to 2021 Tokyo, I just want to experience that again. I want to go get the gold medal and I want to hang my spikes up, and that's how I want to walk away from the sport. So I know from the outside looking in, they're like, oh, he's cocky. No, that's just extreme confidence. Like if I say I'm going to do something, I'm going to do everything that I can to get that something legally. So that's my end goal right now. That's my Avengers end game. Like I have to go to Tokyo and I have to get this gold medal. Now I'll be happy with either three colors, silver, gold, or bronze, but I would like to have gold. And then my little medal family will be happy.
And what event are you planning on competing in?
So I'm going to do the 400. I know at the last 2012 trials, I was the only male athlete to double and do the 200 and 400. Obviously got fifth in the four, and then I was one place away from making the final in the 200, which was just crazy. So this year or next year, I want to do the 400 in hopes of possibly getting an individual 400 spot. We're stacked this year with crazy, crazy talent. But, you know, when you're given a lane and opportunity, you make the most of it. So we'll see what happens. But by virtue of running the four, we actually get an opportunity to run the relay as well. And this year, we're actually going to have an addition to the Olympic Games, which is the mixed 4x4, 4x400 meter relay. So two guys and two girls running the relay that I ran in London. So I would like to be a part of that. It would be the first time ever. So that means whoever wins is going to set a world record, more than likely, and they're going to make history. So I'm all about making history. I would love to be a part of that. I would love to run with Allison Felix. I've trained with her before, but I've never got to run a relay with her. That would be awesome to be able to do that. So that's kind of like my goal right now, but we'll see. It just depends on, you know, how the cards are played, and we'll just go from there.
Right. Okay, so we have a question from Catamount Club board member. Okay, sorry, I'm really bad with names, but Malia Habel. Manteo, who inspires or inspired you the most in your time at WCU?
Could you say that one more time?
Who inspires or inspired you the most during your time at WCU?
Wow, that's really deep. Who inspired me or inspired me the most during my time at WCU? Wow, that's deep. Okay, if I had to I don't like putting people on the spot, but if I had to pinpoint one specific individual, it would be Dr. Justin Menichelli. He is in the, I guess he's still in the sport management or physical education department. I was in his office one time and he was like, Manteo, you're really good in the classroom. You're awesome out of the classroom, but what are you going to do if all else fails? And I remember having that conversation in his office. And from that moment, I really, 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 really started to believe in myself and my craft. And I really started to apply myself, both in the classroom and outside of it on the track. So he became probably one of my biggest fans. And then, of course, you got to throw my coach in there. Danny Williamson took me to unbelievable heights. He still coaches me to this day. And then I would like to say probably most importantly is the student athletes that were around me, my brothers and my sisters, who really, really pushed me to be the best that I could every single day. I didn't win them all. By far, I didn't win them all, but they really pushed me to not only believe in myself, but believe in the team aspect. I always put the team before myself. And I think the lessons that I learned from them and from my coaches and from everyone I was involved with, from the athletic department staff all the way to the trainers and all of that, I think that all the lessons and all the things that I learned from them, I've still continued to this day and just enhanced it and tried to make myself better each day. So I would say those are a few people that, you know, inspired me along the way.
That's awesome. All right. Vic and Jake, what's one thing you guys are missing the most right now of not being at Western and having to practice on your own? What do you miss the most?
Well, outdoor season is always the best, like no mm-hmm. matter what. It makes your spirits high just because you're outside all the time. You're with all of your friends. Like everyone's so close to working together in proximity, because whenever it's indoor season, everyone's super segmented because I mean, you have to practice at different areas, but I really miss being able to be with all of my friends on the track team and all my family, basically outdoors, and just the feeling to practice with them and to compete with them is like no other. And I miss every single bit of that.
I'm not gonna lie. I've been like eating cake and eat ice cream and just enjoying this break a little bit. So I miss the training aspect. And, you know, I see all my teammates talk about, it's my senior year. Oh my God, it's over. This is in the third. And I'm sitting back and I'm like, I'm about to graduate. And I feel like I tapped into my potential a little bit. I've had conversations with my coach, with my trainer, with the head coach. And they were like, if you want to try to go semi-pro, as I've been saying for the longest, go ahead and do your dream. And I said, fine. And like he said, you can do it in color. I believe that the coach that has came into my existence now is one of the best coaches I've had in my entire career. And I feel like I can do that. And so I'm not really concerned or worried about the season being over or anything like that. I'm looking forward in the future. So I'm just kind of preparing and being patient so this can die down so I can get back doing what I got to do.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah, I guess. What about you, Kayla?
Oh, shoot.
So I might be up there.
Oh, what do I miss about? Okay, so I'm definitely a routine person. So going from taking like 21 credit hours, an internship, track practice, like I didn't have time to like sit and think in between my day, and now I have way too much time. So I really miss the routine aspect, and also just like kind of like what you were saying, the sense of community and unity that you get from being around the coaches and like, I don't know, just like kind of motivation and inspiration. And also I have way too much energy now. Like my legs are constantly doing this and I'm just sitting in place. And I think that's part of it too. But yeah, there's a lot of this, honestly, but I was definitely one of those seniors. I was like, oh, it's my senior year and it's canceled. Da, 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 da. It was the opposite of you, Chace, but you know, it's fine, it's life, you move on. Okay, so Manteo, what does the Olympics being postponed mean for your training and athletes across the board to continue training at the level, at that level for another?
It makes me sad to even talk about it because we were right where we needed to be and then boom, it's like shut down. So, I can't speak for all athletes, but I can speak for myself and some of the ones that I'm very close with who I talk to on a daily basis and kind of know where they're at with their career, I would say right now. For me personally, I have access to a track. However, I'm not supposed to be out there. So I'm trying to, first and foremost, it's really all about health for me. I know that I rarely get sick, so I could be carrying this whatever it is, I'm going to call it COVID-19 through 20 because it seems like it's just going to keep going. I could be carrying this and not even know and then give it off to someone else. So I'm trying to keep my distance from people, not only for myself, but for their sake. And then as far as like the Olympics, the whole Olympic trials, just getting ready for that. Obviously, this puts a stop to elite level training. Now, I can still go out and do stuff. I actually go out on the street. And I have stuff marked out for 200 meters, and I'm not going past that. And you know, I have a weight room now that I kind of pieced together. So I'm trying to make the most of, you know, the situation given at where it's at right now, with the idea of not knowing what's to come. I know that they finally canceled the games or postponed them, but 2 weeks before that, I was still training full time. And then the week of, I was still training full time. So right now I've gone to maybe 3 days a week, almost as if I'm just getting back into like fall training, like preseason type, or maybe even summer type stuff. And really that's just to keep me in shape and not get me fat because I literally, when they stopped the games, I'm like, Chace, like I ate everything, everything. Like, just trust me, you don't want to know what I ate.
Yeah.
But like Kayla, like you said, I'm very routine as well. It's not every day is the same, but every day has some kind of feel to it. You know what I'm saying? So if I'm not able to do that, I'm already thrown off anyway. So I'm used to being at practice between the hours of 11 or 10 to 2. Like, that's my window. So now it's like, what do I do between 11 and 2 every single day to make up for that lost time? And then, of course, you know, as athletes, we're used to our heart rate being increased, and we're used to moving our bodies, and we're used to, you know, having that mindset. You may not think of it, but you have a mindset before, during, and after practice. And you don't really get tapped into that mindset anymore, right? So you have to accommodate for that loss, so to speak. So I've been trying to, I have a 7-year-old son, so I've been running around with him. And it's like his energy levels increased by 3,000% when he didn't have to go to school anymore. and virtual learning is not taking away that energy from him. So I have to keep up with him a lot. So that's my training right now. As far as like those two off days. And then, you know, just going forward, you just try to stay positive. You, like I said, you don't know what the season holds. You don't know if you're going to be able to compete again in 2020. However, you take it with pride and you say, okay, either I can sit here and I can get out of shape, or I can still stay on task, maybe not do as much as I was doing. And this is for anybody, honestly, maybe not do as much as I was doing, but try to stay fit. If you can get out and you can abide by the social distancing rules, try to stay fit, try to get some sunlight, try to be positive, I think is kind of like the main goals right now. But yeah, hopefully we can get through this. We can get through this.
For sure. Okay, so we have another question. This one's from Trinity Wiles, 2019 alumna and former track athlete. What skills have you learned from collegiate athletics that translate into the rest of your life?
What skills have I learned from collegiate athletics?
Yeah, that translate into the rest of your life.
Okay. Time management is definitely the first one. Staying on task, completing those tasks in an orderly fashion. But I'm gonna take it a different route. It's very important in college that you remember to take some time for yourself and to appreciate yourself and to care for yourself. So I call it self-time, self-need. There are gonna be times where you're caught up, whether you have a significant other or if you're involved in a lot of clubs and things like that, which are great on the social aspect, but you have to remember to make time for yourself, whether that be mediation or just self-reflection time, or you know, just going out for a walk or going on a hike or anything like that. I know before I got to Western, I didn't know what hiking was, okay? I mean, I had heard about it, but I was like, oh, no, that's not for me. But it's funny enough, like, I used to go on hikes with some of my friends and some of the other athletes and teammates and things like that, or go to the lake or something like that. And that was like my self-reflection time. Like that was the time I needed to really regather all my thoughts and then, you know, push that out into society. So I would say take care of yourself, and that's not being cocky or conceited or anything like that, but you can't expect others to take care of you if you don't take care of yourself, that kind of spiel. So especially as a student athlete, you know, we go through so many things. I remember the good times. I remember the bad times. I remember not knowing one day if I was going to get this done or that done. And then finally, the next day you get it done. And then the stress and pressure from trying to achieve a championship or be at a championship caliber all the time. So I know what you guys go through or what you've gone through. So I think if you just take that and just reflect and really apply yourself, you'll be fine.
Awesome. So this is a question for everyone. Do you guys have any like race day rituals? Like, is there a certain like breakfast you have to eat before you compete? Is there a certain song you have to listen to before you go out and do your thing, or any special lucky socks you have to wear?
I'll let you guys go first.
I gotta eat my gummy bears. They give me energy.
What?
My friends have, yeah, I have like these organic gummy bears, right? And my friends called them my steroids for whatever reason. They're just regular gummy bears. And I eat them and I run fast. That's usually that, or these particular socks, or my lucky underwear, or something crazy. It's nothing real. Like, it's all placebo, but whatever gets the job done, right?
Right.
That's hard. That's a hard question. So I drink an energy drink before I throw, because I mean, throwing is such a long time compared to like the actual runners. Like we have to just like be constantly like ready. So I drink an energy drink, and then I have these little sports beans that are just like little energy, like they're like jelly beans, but they're in little packets for energy. And I guess I have those, but I don't have them every single time. I don't really think it's much of a superstition. Is that it?
Yeah, superstition, ritual, whatever.
A ritual, there we go. Yeah. But no, I don't really think I do much of anything other than just pray to Jesus I don't scratch.
Right.
Yeah, don't scratch. Kayla, what are yours, if you have any?
So the distance team got me into some weird ones this season, actually. So we all started wearing purple sparkly lipstick, like as if the lipstick would make us run faster and also just make us more noticeable. I don't know. We'd also take a shot of espresso about an hour to 2 hours before our event. And I do have a lucky sports bra I always have to wear. And I think that's about it for my day-to-day ritual, or my race day ritual. But huh.
So gummy bears and shots of espresso. We need to call the athletic department and get you guys some gummy bears.
The organic ones, man. The
right.
Organic ones.
That's cool though. I think like Chace said, it's more placebo than anything. But I mean, you just get a feel for how you feel and you just go with it. I know for me personally, I wouldn't say I have any like race day rituals. I have like some pre-race day rituals where, number one, like I have to have my hair, beard, everything has to. I'm a firm believer in it. If you look good, you feel good. Right. You eat well. So, I see you guys are on that method as well. That's what's up. So I take care of all the grooming necessities first, because at the end of the day, for my event, I'm on TV for 44 to 45 seconds. So I have that minimal time to make sure that everything is going according to plan, outside of actually competing. So, you know, at this level, like, and even where you guys are right now, that you are your brand, and what you do with your brand determines how high your brand will go or how far your brand will go. So let's try to always remember that, because at the end of the day, no matter what uniform I have on, whether it's Nike or Team USA or whatever the case may be, at the end of the day, if there's any headline, it's going to say a whole lot of stuff before it gets to the comma and then my name. And one of those things is Western Carolina University. So just always remember that, you know, you're putting on for Western no matter what you do from here on out.
That's good advice. Dick and Chase, is there anything you want to ask or discuss?
I had a question. Sorry. I wanted to know, how do you think that your experience at Western shaped you into who you are today?
Could you say that a little bit louder?
Sorry. How has your experience at Western Carolina shaped who you are today?
Right. My experiences at Western were probably way more different than your experiences are right now. You guys have a lot more, I wouldn't say opportunities, but you have a lot more in your surrounding than, you know, my student athletes did. And that's not a negative by any means, but it's great to see how much Western has grown. I mean, I come up there every year and it just looks totally different. I'm like, wow, this is crazy. Like the expansion and all the different things that are being built on. So that's always great. But for me personally, I think the experiences there not only shaped me as a student athlete, but more so as a man as well. Having those direct influences, whether it be my teammates or my coaches or my professors or even my advisor, anybody that, you know, the community who supported me and still support me to this day, being able to have that outlet and to have that around you, it always makes you want to grind even harder. So I think just being able to have those experiences and to be able to compete at a very, very high level, even in the collegiate realm of things, it definitely transferred over to where I'm at right now. I'm so grateful, and I owe a great debt to Western Carolina University and all those people that I've discussed earlier, because they helped me to get to where I'm at. It wasn't just me by myself. It's always been, you know, the people around me and my team, my circle of people that have, you know, pushed me in the classroom, outside the classroom, in every endeavor. So, yeah, I hope that answers your question.
Okay, I do have a question. I want to pick your brain, though.
Oh, gosh.
Now, how did you go from graduating in 2009 and preparing for the 2012 Olympics? Because the way that I'm looking at my trajectory for this particular situation is I'm not looking for 2020, 2021 at this point in the game, but 2025, I guess, at this point, preparing myself for that. So how did you do that transition? Because I'm about to really take a leap of faith and not know what's about to happen next, literally.
Yeah, that's a great question. And I've been asked this question probably two other times, and I'm going to give you the same answer that I gave then, because I feel like it's the most honest and most true. For me, when I graduated in August of 2000, or maybe it was May of 2009, I was faced with the decision like, okay, you're kind of on the cusp of hitting the ACE standard. Do you want to take a risk and try to go pro or whatever and see what happens? Or do you want to go into grad school and really accomplish that side of the goal? So I decided to do both at the same time. I started grad school, and I was a grad assistant coach with at Western. And in doing so, I also trained post-collegiately at the time until I turned pro in officially 2011. But I would honestly say 2012. So I was on the post-collegiate train for quite some time. I went over to Europe. I got a taste of that. I took some L's. I took some major L's. But I also took some major wins as well. And that experience, I think, is what allowed me to really say, okay, yeah, I'm ready for this. And then I took the next step in doing that. But obviously with track and field, you know, it's not to deter anyone's dreams, anyone who's watching or you guys that are here with track and field, you know how hard our sport is. You know that it's really three spots up for grabs, technically speaking. And it's one of the hardest sports to even go professional in. However, with that being said, that's what pushed me to even try to go after it, because I don't like being told no. Especially if it's something that I control dominantly. So, I say that to say, for you personally, like I would sit down and I would weigh out all outcomes. So you write out what are your pros, what are your cons, and what you want to achieve, how you're going to achieve it. And that's something you can do with your coach as well. And I think once you have that sit down conversation, you will know exactly what you need to do.
Okay.
I can assure you that. That's how we did it. So I can assure you it will let you see things more clear.
Gotcha.
Yeah, yeah. And I'm always here too. You know how to reach me. I'm here as well. So I always help out.
Appreciate it.
Yeah, man.
Okay, so we have another question.
I have a question. Can I have a question though?
Go for it.
Can I have a question? I didn't mean to jump. No, you go first, and then I'll ask all three of you one, because I have questions.
Okay. Are you sure?
Yeah, I'm positive.
Okay, so Catamount SID Daniel Hooker asked, Daniel,
my guy,
do you have any hidden talent that you picked up at WVU, like for gripping on the sidelines at football?
Hold on, wait, what? What was that?
Do you have any hidden talent you picked up at WCU, like cord gripping on the sidelines at football games?
Yo, Hook, come on, man. So what he's referring to, when Western had TV games for football, I would work and hold the parabola that picks up the sound for all the games. It was just cool, little side job. And plus, I got to have the best view of the football game. So That's what I'm talking about. So yeah, I'm an expert level parabola holder. So I'm sure that's what he's referring to. But no, to go back on Hook, like Hook's one of my good friends. He definitely inspired me to do what I'm doing right now, which is off the track. I'm doing some sports analyst and color analyst work for NBC Sports. So that's been pretty cool. You know, he's the guy there at Western that does all that stuff. So broadcasting and all that stuff. So Hook, shout out to you, man. I appreciate you for instilling in me the qualities of being not only a great parabola holder, but a great vocalist to use my voice for higher power. Thank you so much. that is funny. I'm going to text you, bro. I'm going to text you. Let's see. I guess this is a universal question. What is your favorite moment from Western? I know you two are seniors and you're a sophomore, but surely you've had like a great moment so far. So what is that great moment, whether it's on the track or off the track? Actually, do one on and one off. And then what is the best things? What is one of the best things that have changed about you since coming to Western Carolina?
Ooh.
One thing that has changed you since coming to Western Carolina. Yeah, you got to think deep on this one.
Yeah, this one's difficult. Anybody else want to go first?
Yeah, Kayla, all you.
Okay, so I think like the best moment on the track was probably I got to go to conference for indoor this season, and it just so happened to be on my birthday. And last season I took a year off. So I took a year off, did early train, and then I came back and was actually running faster than what I have had. And I just think that like I owe a lot of that to Jesse. He really helped. Coach Jesse really helped train me and put me in a good mindset, and like also the team environment really made a difference with that too. So it was really cool that my senior year I got to go to a conference for indoor, especially since we didn't have a spring season either. So it was a good note to end on, and I ran a PR. So as far as my favorite moment is Western, dang, that is a hard one. Okay, wait, I'm going to start with the thing that's changed about me the most since I've been at Western is I definitely think like I am a lot more open-minded. It's really neat meeting people from like different walks of life, different backgrounds, different religions, like, and just being like able to open your mind and understand where they're coming from. And I think that's helped prepare me like both professionally and as a person. I think I'm more personable and like more capable of taking on like different challenges and like looking through a more cultural lens. But right. I still don't know what my favorite moment at Western is. Trying to think of a family friendly one.
Gotta keep it classy here with the cats. You know how we do it.
I think probably one of my favorites was actually when it was during my recruit visit. They used to keep the press box open, and you could go up there. We would go up there at night. We'd bring blankets and a speaker, and you could lay on top of the press box and look at the stars and, like, look over all of Western and, like, the mountain line. And it's just a very humbling experience. Like, kind of like you said, like, with all the hiking and stuff, I really enjoy that just because it's very humbling and, like, makes you realize that your problems aren't as big as what you think they are, you know? And just,
I like that.
Yeah. I like that. Okay.
Chace and Victoria, you guys have a tough act to follow there.
She's been there longer than I have. Hold on.
For you, it's going to be a little different because you've only been, 2 years, right?
Yeah, 2 years.
Yeah.
It might have, my favorite experience or the thing on the track at least was coming in 9 weeks of training and dropping. A whole second off my regular PR, but 2 seconds and some change off of my opening is like 400 time. And nice. doing that in 9 weeks of training and then breaking the SoCon record in the 4x4. That was my best experience on the track, my first semester. Besides that, my best experience outside of it is, like I said earlier, making brothers and sisters and, like, finding people that I really truly connect with. And like she said earlier, the open-mindedness, but being able to branch myself out and becoming a, I feel like a better person at the end of the day, a more selfless person. What have I learned? I guess I hit both of them at the same time, both questions. But yeah. I've learned a lot though. I've learned a lot about myself being at Western, and the whole shebang. My coach tried to get me to come way long time ago, and I was like, nah, I'm not going. I'm gonna go to my other school. And Western Carolina was the best decision of my life personally. Like, my dream that I had was dying at my old school, and I came to Western, and the dream that I have is alive and kicking, and I fully fledged believe I can do whatever's put in front of me since Western Carolina came into my life. So,
okay.
Yeah.
I like that.
Wow.
Big.
Good. All right.
Go ahead and throw it at us.
I could easily, that was, yeah, good pun. For a track. Okay. So I could easily say that, like, one of my favorite moments was winning, like, conference in my event, but I don't think that's it personally, because whenever it happened, yes, I was excited. I didn't really, like, understand the severity of it, but I think my biggest thing is the adversities that we came over with losing coaches. We lost a couple coaches, especially my throws event group. We've gone through like three in the last year. And but my freshman year, I came in, and within the first couple months, our coach left. And that was a really big thing for me, because I had to step up, not only with my teammates who were really down because they lost someone they were so close to, but as a person, since I was new, I had to make sure that I hit the goals I wanted to achieve. So I think my biggest thing was getting over all of the adversities that were thrown at us and still being able to pull out a number one title. And that was one of the biggest things. I was more impressed with myself than I ever have been. And I think that's another big thing going off of what I have learned, even though I've only been here for 2 years. I've learned that I can put trust in myself, and then I can do whatever I put my mind to. One of my best friends, who's also a thrower, her name's Amy, and her motto is, you are your own outcome. And you are. Ooh. So you can do whatever you put your mind to, but if you don't want to actually practice the mental state and the physical being of being in that outcome, you'll never hit it. And I think that I've learned that I'm a lot stronger mentally and physically than I ever thought I was coming into college.
Okay, you three are going places, man. Like, that's awesome. Like, for real. Your head's on straight. No, that's really, really good. Like, for real. And I think being in an environment where you're given the opportunity to be you, but also be a part of something special, whether it be, you know, for us, it's obviously a conference championship team, or even if you're at a scored event or whatever the case may be, obviously you want to be at your very best for those people that are around you, not only just you, but being given the opportunity. I know, like you said, Victoria, with the coaches and interchanging like that can, a lot of people on the outside may not understand how difficult that is, because you become accustomed to a certain system, a certain way of life, so to speak. And then all of a sudden it's just taken away from you, or it leaves, or whatever it is. And then you have to readjust and start all over from scratch, like ground zero again. So again, that's just adversity. And there's going to be times where obviously you've been faced with it before, but we're always going to be faced with, no pun intended, but with a hurdle. And it's really all about how you get over that hurdle. Sometimes you can go under it. Sometimes you can go through it. But really, we want to just get over that hurdle and not go around it, because, you know, there's always going to, like I said, there's always going to be adversity. There's always going to be people who are against you. But at the end of the day, you have to stay true to yourself, true to your morals, true to, you know, everything that you know you're capable of doing. And usually 9 times out of 10, you know, you have to have that one negative. 9 times out of 10, you achieve the level of success that you were supposed to achieve in the first place. So those are great answers, guys. Great answers.
Thank you.
Okay, so we do have another question from student Madison Lovinggood. What are Manteo's degrees in?
What are Manteo's degrees in? Let me look. Bachelor of Science in Sport Management with a concentration in Athletic Administration. And I also picked up a minor in Marketing there. Actually, was it a double major Marketing? Some of the classes like interchange, so you could pick up one more class and still get the, you know, so that. And then graduate school, I did Comprehensive Physical Education. And then I also have an MBA as well. So your boy's been busy in the classroom.
Okay. Yeah.
But I didn't get my MBA from Western though. All the other degrees are from Western Carolina University. Hey, don't do that. Okay. 75% of them are, no, 80% of them from, you know, from Western. So the majority counts, right? So. But yeah, and to go further on that, I've always wanted to be an athletic administrator or to work in the academic side of athletics. People always say I should coach, which I feel like I'd be a great coach, but I'd rather just be someone that can advise, like an advisor to the team, something like that. I don't want to be given the responsibility of programming and all that. It's a lot. I've done it before. It's a lot of work. So all you student athletes that just show up to practice, just know your coaches are putting in work, and not only your coaches, but your advisors, they're putting in work to make sure that they get you to the best of your ability. So you should always be grateful to them.
Oh, I hear that daily with Derek. Derek's is on time. Oh yeah.
Man, Atkins, man.
I love him to death. That's my dude.
Well, did anyone have any other questions?
How are you doing in this quarantine?
Who said that? How are we doing in the quarantine?
Mm-hmm.
Man, a lot of reading. I'll be honest.
Reading YouTube.
So I like to sing, right? I've been making music like every day. So this downtime has given me the opportunity to do one of my favorite hobbies, which is sing. So I've been blowing that up. So yeah, that's pretty. What's that look for, man?
Album soon.
Hey, I might drop an EP on them.
All right.
Quarantine and Me, Volume 1. No, hey, seriously,
if it goes Spotify.
It's kind of hard to record like here because you have all the outside noise, and I have a 7-year-old, so there's no way to soundproof that. but if I can get to a studio, I'm really thinking about doing that.
That'd be awesome.
Yep. So if you guys have any resources, let me know. Let me know. Hook, I know you're watching. So, yeah.
All right. So I think that might, does anyone have any more questions? No? Okay. Well, thank you guys so much for joining us.
Thank you.
That was fun. Hey, like I said, though, for real, if you guys need a resource or someone to talk to, I'm here. I promise you. At Manteo Mitchell, just on everything.
Okay. No, I was going to really use that as my resource. I've been trying to pick people's brains and start businesses, so I can do this athletic thing. And this is another way I can get another resource. And I appreciate the experience.
I'm here, man. I'm here. I promise.
Just follow me back.
I got you. Look, here's the thing, though. I knew that was coming. Here's the thing. I don't get notifications for, like, that stuff. So you have to send me a message, and I have to go on it, like, right then, and then I'll know it's you, and I'll follow.
Gotcha.
I promise.
No, you good.
Get you with that Catamount, the Catamount promise.
Catamount promise. Okay.
That's what we used to do. Like on the team, we'd be like,
"What is this? What
was this bad?" Catamount, man. Catamount, man.
That's awesome.
Y'all funny.
All right. Well, thank you to all of our viewers who joined us today, and everyone who joined our conference call. But appreciate it. Stay healthy, stay happy, and go Cats.
Cats.
See, go Cats. All that. She did.